Daddy's Little Soldier by Maggie Hartley. Read by Penelope McDonald. Chapter 1. Changes. It was finally the big day. Louisa, the young woman I'd fostered for the last 10 years, was about to show me the flat that she was hoping to buy. She couldn't wipe the smile off her face as she excitedly led me through the front door. "Well, Maggie," she asked, "what do you think?" This was the first time I'd seen the one-bedroom flat that she and her fiancé Charlie had offered on. 2-year-old Ben wriggled impatiently in my arms, so I put him down while I had a proper look round. "I know new builds aren't really your thing, but it's gorgeous, isn't it?" she grinned. I smiled at the fact that Louisa knew me so well. My house was a Victorian terrace, and I loved period properties with their high ceilings and creaky floorboards, whereas I knew Louisa preferred things to be brand spanking new. This flat was certainly that. Everything sparkled and gleamed, from the chrome taps and the shiny new laminate on the floor to the stonework surfaces in the pristine white kitchen. "It's perfect, lovey," I smiled. "I can just imagine the two of you here." "I've told Charlie I'm not moving in until after the wedding, though," replied Louisa. "I want to do everything properly." "That's very honourable and old-fashioned of you," I teased. Her happiness was infectious. However, behind my smile, I felt a wave of sadness. Things were changing, and as proud as I was of Louisa and all she had achieved, I couldn't help the pang of loss I felt at the thought of her moving out. Louisa had moved in with me as a teenager after her parents had tragically died in a car crash. I'd fostered her permanently until she was officially out of the care system. She'd lived with me for a decade now, and to all intents and purposes, she was my daughter. However, when she and Charlie, a mechanic, had got engaged nearly 2 years ago, I knew that eventually this day was going to come. The wedding was booked for 3 months' time, and after much hard work and saving, they finally had enough of a deposit to buy their first place together. "You've got so much to look forward to," I smiled wistfully. "I've got so much to do, more like," sighed Louisa. "My head's buzzing with all the wedding stuff we need to get done, not to mention the flat." Suddenly, I heard a noise coming from the bathroom. It sounded as if Ben was getting up to mischief. "Right, I better go and get that little one out of here before he destroys your lovely new home," I grinned at her. Ben had been with me for 4 months now. He was an adorable toddler who could charm the birds from the trees. He was mixed race and he had gorgeous, huge brown eyes and a cute grin. He'd been taken into care after his biological mother, Kim, had died of a drugs overdose. The poor little mite had been found curled up by her body on a mattress on the floor of their council flat a few hours later. Thankfully, a neighbour had heard him crying and had looked through the window to check what was happening. But I still dreaded to think of what could have happened. His mum had already had a daughter removed from her at birth 7 years ago because of her drug problems, but had then seemed to be getting her life back on track. Although social services had been involved throughout her pregnancy and Ben's first few months, she was clean from drugs and Ben was born fit and healthy. He was well cared for, so he wasn't deemed as at risk, and there had been no ongoing social services involvement after his first birthday until the day he'd been found by his mother's body. Ben might have been cute, but he was very curious and into everything. I peeked my head around the bathroom and found him about to flush a toilet roll down the loo. "Come on, you," I smiled, scooping him up. "Let's go to playgroup and you can have a good run around." He beamed at me in return and cuddled into my neck. Louise had the day off from her job as a nanny and was heading home to sort out some wedding stuff. "This is going to be a lovely home for you and Charlie," I told her, meaning it. "I'm really happy for you." "Thanks, Maggie," she smiled, walking us out to the hall. We were just about to leave when my mobile rang. I fished it out of my handbag and saw the familiar name flash up on the screen. "It's Becky," I told Louisa. "Would you mind keeping an eye on Ben for me?" I handed him to her and then quickly answered before it went to voicemail. Becky was my supervising social worker at the fostering agency that I worked for. We'd worked together for years and had a good relationship. "Hi, Maggie. Where are you at the moment?" "I was just about to head to playgroup with Ben," I replied. "Why?" "I think your plans might be about to change," she told me. She explained that social services were looking for a foster carer to take on a little boy who had suddenly come into care. "All I know is that his name's Tom, he's 8 and he's currently at school," she said. "He's already known to social services and, for whatever reason, they don't feel it's safe for him to go home today." As was often the case with children who came into my care, at this early stage, I didn't know what the issues were or how long he was likely to be with me. "Of course, I'd be happy to help," I told her. "I've got the room, and I'm sure Ben would love having another little boy in the house to play with." "Thanks, Maggie," said Becky, sounding relieved. "I was hoping you'd say that. I don't know the exact timings, but I suspect the social worker will be with you in the next couple of hours. They're just applying to the court for an EPO now, as his family are not willing to cooperate, apparently." An EPO was an emergency protection order, which meant that social services could remove a child they felt was in immediate danger without the cooperation of the biological parents. "OK," I said. "I'll head straight home now." As I ended the call with Becky, I experienced that strange mix of anticipation and nerves that I always felt when a new child was on their way to me. I enjoyed the challenge of getting to know a new little one and trying to help them, but I was always apprehensive about what I was about to face or what kind of state they'd be in when they arrived. "There's been a slight change of plan," I told Louisa, taking Ben off her. "We're heading home now after all." I explained to her about the new placement that would be coming to stay with us. "Gosh, okay," she said. "Why has the little boy been taken into care?" "I don't know yet, Flower," I said. But I knew that we would soon find out. As soon as I stepped through the front door, I got to work making sure the spare bedroom was ready for Tom, as well as digging out some clothes in his size. Several months ago, I'd fostered a group of 3 siblings, and one of them, Sean, was 7, so I had quite a few 7 to 8-year-old bits left over from when he was with me. I was assuming that if Tom was coming straight from school, then he wouldn't have anything with him. A couple of hours passed, and there was still no sign of Tom or the social worker. I gave Ben his lunch and put him down for a nap, and left Louisa to get on with sorting out wedding stuff on her laptop. Ben had been asleep for half an hour when I finally heard the doorbell go. I instinctively rushed to the door so the noise wouldn't wake him up. A woman in her 40s with long red hair was standing there, and she had a familiar face. "Hello, Maggie," she smiled. "It's been a long time. How are you?" "Liz," I said, suddenly realising who she was. "I'm well, thanks." I'd worked with Liz Fleming several years ago when she was the social worker for a little girl I'd fostered called Ruth. "This is Tom," she told me, gesturing towards the small figure beside her. I smiled at the serious-faced little boy standing on the doorstep. Compared to how some of the children I foster turn up when they're first taken into care, he looked immaculate. His short brown hair was clean and neatly cut, and his pristine school uniform fitted him perfectly. He wasn't dirty or emaciated, and there were no obvious signs of physical neglect, as is so often the case when children arrive at my door. "I'm Maggie," I told him gently. "Come in and I'll show you around." He stared back at me with his big blue eyes, not saying a single word. Liz ushered him through to the kitchen, smiling kindly. "How's Louisa?" asked Liz. "I remember hearing that Lily had gone back to live with her mum." "Gosh, yes. That was a while ago," I replied, smiling at the memory of another little girl I'd fostered alongside Ruth. "And Louisa's great. She's buying a flat and getting married in a few months." "Wow," sighed Liz. "She was just a teenager when I saw you last." Throughout all of our chit-chat, Tom still hadn't said a word and was standing with his back very straight, his hands behind his back. "Would you like some juice and a biscuit?" I asked him gently, and he nodded. I poured out a beaker of orange squash and got him a hobnob from the biscuit barrel. Do you like Lego? I asked him. He shrugged. Well, in my toy cupboard I've got lots of really cool Lego, so I'll get that out for you and perhaps you can see what you can make while I talk to Liz in the front room. Is that okay, Tom? Liz asked, and he nodded. I set it out for him on the kitchen table, but he just sat and stared at it. I thought perhaps he might feel more comfortable playing with it when Liz and I weren't hovering around him, so I made us a cup of tea and we went through to the living room. Poor little lad, she sighed. I think he's a bit bewildered by everything that's happened to him today. So what can you tell me about him? I asked her. Why has he come into the care system? He looks very well looked after, so it's clearly not a case of physical neglect. She explained that she'd first come into contact with Tom and his dad Mark a month ago. Just over 9 months ago, Mark's wife Jess tragically died, leaving him as a single parent to Tom, she said. She had bowel cancer that quickly spread to her lungs. Oh, that's so sad, I sighed. That can't have been easy for Tom, losing his mum at such a young age. No, agreed Liz. It was sudden, too. By the time it was diagnosed, it was too late for treatment, and she died within a matter of weeks. I think it was extremely hard for both of them. She explained that Mark had been a soldier in the army for years, but when Jess died, he had been forced to resign. He couldn't go on army tours whilst also looking after Tom, so he found a job as a labourer on a building site. Everything was okay at first, but lately Tom's school has become concerned that Mark isn't coping. Tom had always arrived at school looking clean and well presented, but for several days in a row, instead of a packed lunch, he was just bringing a single slice of bread to school. He explained to the dinner staff that it was okay as it was part of his punishment. Punishment? I asked, puzzled. What on earth does that mean? Well, exactly, Liz sighed. The school phoned Mark a few times to say it wasn't acceptable, but he was very hostile towards them, saying he knew what was best for his son. Liz explained that Tom's teacher had also become increasingly concerned about his behaviour in class. Apparently, he used to be a chatty little thing, she told me, very bright and in the top sets for maths and literacy. But in the past few months, he's become very withdrawn. He hardly says a word in class now, doesn't mix with any of the other pupils anymore. He refuses to go out at playtime and his work has gone downhill. The school asked Dad to go in and talk to them about it, but he refused point blank. They eventually called social services in just to cover their backs, I think. Liz described how she had gone to visit Mark at home. Unsurprisingly, he wasn't very pleased to see me. He wouldn't say much, was hostile and wouldn't let me into the house. Things came to a head today when Tom came to school and said his dad had hit him because he hadn't completed his chores. He told his teacher that it wasn't the first time it had happened. Naturally, given everything that's gone on, we're just concerned and want to look into it further to check everything is okay at home and make sure that Tom's not in any danger. Mark won't cooperate with us, so the only way we could do that is by issuing an EPO. It sounded like a complicated situation. Tom's been checked over and he hasn't got a mark on him, but we do need to look into the hitting incident and decide if we need to involve the police. As well as finding out more about Tom's background, my mind was also turning to the practicalities of the next few days. What about school? I asked. Is he able to go back to his primary school, or do you want me to organise a place for him at my local school? Liz looked like she was weighing up the situation. I think he should be fine staying where he is for now, she said. It will provide some stability and familiarity for him while all this is going on, and there's no suggestion Daddy's going to try and snatch him or approach him at school. The head and his teacher know what's going on, so they can keep an eye on things. Liz explained that his current school was half an hour's drive away from my house. I can organise a support worker to come and collect him and do the school run, but it might take a couple of days to find someone, she said. I'm happy to do it, I told her. Ben, the other little boy I'm fostering, is only two, so he's not at school or nursery yet, so I don't have any other drop-offs. Thank you, Maggie, she smiled. That's one less thing I need to sort out. I'm going to try and talk to Dad now and set up a contact session in the next couple of days, she said. The session would be supervised at a contact centre, and it would also be useful for social workers to see Tom and his dad together to help determine what the next steps might be. We walked back into the kitchen together. Tom was still sitting stiffly at the table, the Lego untouched in front of him. Tom, I've got to go back to the office now, so I'm going to leave you with Maggie, okay? But I'll try and pop in to see you tomorrow. He nodded, but didn't say a word. I walked Liz to the door. Despite the circumstances, it was nice to see you again, Maggie, she said. Say hello to Louisa for me. I will do, I replied. She's been upstairs on that laptop for ages now, wedding planning. It's all she seems to do at the moment. I'm really happy for her, smiled Liz. Keep in touch, Maggie, and I'll speak to you tomorrow, she added. I hope Tom settles in all right. So do I thought, as I closed the door behind her. I walked back into the kitchen to find Tom sitting at the kitchen table, the Lego still untouched. He looked so forlorn, and my heart went out to him. I felt so sorry for this poor boy and everything he'd been through. He tragically lost his mum, and now he'd been taken away from his dad, the only person he had left in his little world, but perhaps also the person he was most in danger from. Chapter 2 Neat and Tidy. I was wondering what to do next when the baby monitor crackled, and suddenly I heard Ben's familiar cries. Tom looked puzzled. What's that? He asked. It was the first time that he'd said anything. You mean, who's that? I smiled. That's Ben, who lives here with me too. He's two, and he's been having his lunchtime sleep. I took Tom to the front room and put the TV on for him while I quickly went upstairs to get Ben. As I passed her bedroom, I popped my head around Louisa's door. She was sprawled on the bed with her laptop and headphones on. I waved to get her attention. The little boy's arrived, I told her. His name's Tom. Oh, how is he? She asked. Is he okay? Understandably, he's overwhelmed and frightened, so he's been very quiet. But on the face of it, he seems very clean and well presented. Poor little lad, she sighed. He must be really scared. I'm going to take Ben down to meet him now, so why don't you pop down in a bit to say hello, I suggested to her. I will do, she said. I've looked at so many pictures of wedding flowers, it's making my head ache. I went to get Ben, who was standing up in his cot waiting for me. He always looked really adorable when he first woke up and was still half asleep. His face was flushed and his hair was all ruffled up. He suddenly looked far too grown up to be in a cot, and I made a mental note to transfer him to a toddler bed this coming weekend. Come on then, Mr. B, I cooed as I lifted him out. Did you have a nice nap? Let's go and introduce you to Tom. I carried him down to the living room. I'd left Tom the remote and showed him how to turn the TV on, but he hadn't touched it, and he was sitting there, staring at a blank screen. I sat down next to him and put Ben on my lap, but he quickly got up and started toddling around the room. Tom stared at him curiously. Why does he live here? He asked. Sadly, his mummy died, so I'm looking after him until we find a new mummy and daddy for him, I said. As soon as the words were out of my mouth, I could have kicked myself. I didn't want to lie to Tom about why Ben was with me, but perhaps it was a bit insensitive after everything he'd been through recently, losing his mum. But his expression didn't change, and he didn't say a word. A few minutes later, Louisa came down and introduced herself. Luckily, Tom didn't ask why she lived with me, so thankfully we didn't have to talk any more about parents dying. I left Louisa to keep an eye on Ben while I showed Tom around the house and the room where he'd be sleeping. He was still very quiet, but I could see that he was looking around, taking everything in. "I'm going to start making dinner soon," I said to him later on that afternoon. "Do you like pasta?" He nodded. "I can help you," he said eagerly. "I know how to cook pasta and I can set the table." It was the most animated I'd seen him since he'd arrived. "That's very kind of you, lovey, but you've had a long day, so why don't you have a look through the toy cupboard and see if there's anything you'd like to play with? There are some really fun puzzles and games in there, and a castle and soldiers." The toy cupboard was also in the kitchen, which meant that I could keep an eye on him and Ben as I cooked. While Ben toddled around, happily playing with Duplo and cars, Tom just sat there, a serious look on his face. I thought back to how he'd been earlier with the Lego, not touching it. It was almost as if he didn't know how to play. When dinner was ready, we all sat around the table together. Ben noisily clamoured as he fed himself pasta, getting more on his face and high chair than in his mouth. In contrast, Tom sat there quietly using his knife and fork to eat his food. "Thank you," he said, as he put the cutlery down neatly on his plate to indicate that he'd finished. His table manners were impeccable, and it was such a contrast to the majority of children I was used to. When we'd all finished, Tom jumped up and started clearing away the dirty plates. Louisa looked at me and raised her eyebrows in surprise. "That's so helpful of you, Flower, but I'll do that," I told him. "I can wash up," he said, "or I can dry the dishes." "Well, we're very lucky in this house because I've got a dishwasher," I smiled. "So all I need to do is load it up and switch it on. It's lovely that you offered, though." I should have been thanking my lucky stars that such a polite, helpful child had come to stay with us. But there was something very odd about it. Tom's behaviour seemed almost mechanical. He was like an obedient little robot. As nice as it was for me, I knew it wasn't normal behaviour for an 8-year-old boy. I was sure Tom must have been exhausted after such a traumatic day, so I was keen to get him into bed and try and get him settled as soon as possible. I ran him a bath while he watched TV downstairs, and I got Ben ready for bed. I'd found that 8 was a tricky age, in that children often felt self-conscious and wouldn't want to get undressed in front of me. But they weren't quite old enough to lock themselves in the bathroom and do everything themselves. Every child was different, and I had to work out what each was comfortable with. "You hop in and have a good wash," I told him when the bath was ready. "Do you know how to wash your hair, or do you need me to do it for you?" I asked him. "I know how to do it," he told me. "I can get washed myself." "That's brilliant," I smiled. "There's a jug on the side to help you rinse the shampoo out." I made sure he kept the door slightly ajar, and after 5 minutes I knocked on the bathroom door. "Are you okay in there, lovey?" I asked. "Can I pop in and get your clothes?" "Okay," he shouted. He seemed to be having a nice soak in the bath. I expected to have to pick his school uniform up off the floor, but it was neatly folded up in a pile on top of the laundry basket. "Will you be all right in there for a few more minutes, Flower, while I put Ben to bed? There's a towel and some pyjamas for you there when you're ready," I told him. I put Ben down in record time, and 5 minutes later, I went to check back on Tom. To my surprise, he was already out of the bath and had returned to his bedroom. His door was open, but I tapped gently on it before I walked in. He was dressed in his pyjamas, lying in bed on his back, staring at the ceiling. "Wow, you're so grown up," I smiled. "You've managed to get yourself all ready for bed. Have you brushed your teeth and everything?" He nodded. "Good boy," I told him. "Well, if you're all sorted, then all I need to do is say good night. If you need anything at all, you just shout for me, okay?" He nodded. I turned to go out when he began to speak. "My mummy died too, like Ben's one," he said matter-of-factly. I went over to him and knelt down on the floor next to the bed, aware that this was the first time he'd spoken about his family. "I'm so sorry," I said gently. "That must be really hard for you, lovey. You must miss her very much." I waited in the hope he might open up to me and say something else. But instead, he closed his eyes. "I'm going to go to sleep now," he said. I'd expected him to ask about his dad and when he was going to be able to go home, but he hadn't said a word about him. But he'd been through so much today, and it was late, so I didn't push him to talk. "Good night, Tom," I told him. "See you in the morning." As I closed the door slightly, he was still lying there, like a stiff little statue on his back. I went back downstairs where Louisa was watching TV. "Is he okay?" she asked. "He seems really sad." "He's all right," I told her. "It's normal for him to be quiet after everything that's happened to him today." I spent the rest of the evening making sure that I was organised for the following morning. Thankfully, there wasn't a mark on Tom's uniform, so it would do for him the following day without having to wash it. While Louisa watched EastEnders, I checked where his school was on my tablet and what route I'd need to take. My mobile ringing in the kitchen disturbed my chain of thought. As I ran to answer it, I expected it to be my link worker, Becky. But when I got to it, I saw Graham's number flashing up on the screen. Graham was the man that I'd been seeing for the past few years. He was a physiotherapist in his 40s, and even though we'd known each other a long time, our relationship was still very casual. My fostering was so full on most of the time that it took someone very patient to understand that this role would always come first. Graham thankfully did. I knew he got frustrated from time to time when a new child arrived and I wasn't able to see him for weeks on end, but I had always been clear about that. When I did get the chance to see him, I enjoyed his company, and it was nice to have someone to go to the cinema or the pub with. We'd even been on holiday together a few times. As I answered the phone, I suddenly remembered that I'd promised to give Graham a call that evening to make plans for the weekend. "I'm so sorry," I sighed. "I know I said I'd ring, but a new foster child arrived today." Although I never shared any confidential details about the children with him, he liked to know who I was looking after. I told him about Tom. "He sounds like a lovely little boy," he said. "Why is he in care?" "That's what we're trying to find out," I said. "It often takes a few days or even weeks to build up a proper picture of a child's life. What with little Ben to look after and now Tom too, I don't think I'll get the chance to meet you this weekend now. I'm really sorry." Graham chuckled. "Sounds like you've got your hands full. I know things will be full on, Maggie, but keep in touch, and maybe you could pop out for a quick drink next week." "I'll try my best," I promised. When I got off the phone, Louisa raised her eyebrows at me. "Was that Graham?" she smiled. She still thought it was hilarious that I had a boyfriend at my age. "Maybe you two could have a double wedding with me and Charlie," she teased. "Oh, you're so rude to me," I scolded, pretending to be cross with her, but I couldn't help but grin. Once I'd got everything sorted for the morning, I decided to get an early night too. Normally, I never sleep well on the first night that I have a new child in the house. I always worry about how they're feeling, and I constantly have one ear out to check that they're okay. I looked in on Tom before I went to bed, and he was fast asleep, still lying perfectly still on his back, just as I'd left him. I didn't hear a peep from either him or Ben, but I had a restless night, tossing and turning. I must have finally nodded off just before my alarm went off at 6:45 a.m. Thankfully, Ben was a good sleeper, and I liked to try and get showered and dressed before he woke up shortly after 7 a.m, as it was easier that way. He was into everything, so once he was awake, it was impossible to find the time to get ready in peace. There had been no noise from Tom, so I assumed he was still fast asleep. I pulled on my dressing gown and crept down the landing to the bathroom. As I passed the bedroom where Tom was, I glanced in and did a double take. The bed was empty and perfectly made. The pillows were plumped up and the duvet had been smoothed down so there wasn't a single wrinkle in it. The pyjamas Tom had been wearing were neatly folded up and had been placed on the pillow. My stomach dropped as I walked in and saw that there was no sign of Tom. I dashed to the bathroom, but that was empty too. Where on earth was he? I felt sick as the worst-case scenario ran through my head that he had got up in the night and run away. He was only 8, for goodness sake. I quickly ran downstairs. He wasn't in the living room, but as I walked into the kitchen, I felt a rush of relief as I saw a small figure sitting at the table and had to fight to keep my voice steady. "There you are," I gasped. "You're up early." He was sitting there, dressed in his school uniform, with his hair neatly brushed. There were cereal bowls and plates set out for 3 people on the table. "Sorry, I didn't know where you kept the knives and spoons, so I couldn't set it properly," he told me apologetically. "Wow," I said, slightly shocked. "Thank you for doing all this, and I can fetch the cutlery. Give me 10 minutes to quickly have a shower, then I'll come down and sort out breakfast, OK?" "I don't mind doing it," replied Tom. "Honestly, Flower, it's OK. Ben will be up soon and he'll want some cereal too, so it's best I do it." I was so relieved that Tom was all right. I knew I was probably overreacting, but he'd given me the shock of my life disappearing from his bedroom like that. I went back upstairs to the bathroom and turned the shower on. I looked around, puzzled. The array of toothbrushes that were usually scattered all over the shelf above the sink were neatly arranged in a glass beaker. And for the first time ever, the lid was on the toothpaste. The actual shelf itself and the mirror were gleaming as though they'd been cleaned, and the hand towel that usually ended up on the floor had been neatly folded and placed on the radiator. Even the toilet seat was down. I was stunned. It was like a fairy had been in overnight and tidied it all up. Normally, when I fostered children, particularly boys, my bathroom and the downstairs loo were like a war zone. There would be toilet roll trailing, puddles of wee on the floor and all over the toilet seat, and it normally hadn't been flushed. The tap was often left running, and usually the hand towel would be crumpled up on the floor. This should have been a welcome change, and it was. But it also bothered me too. It seemed unnatural for an 8-year-old to be so clinically neat and tidy. I quickly had a shower, got dressed, and went back downstairs where Tom was still sitting quietly at the table. "Gosh, you left your bedroom and the bathroom very clean indeed," I told him. "Is that what you used to do at home?" "Yes," he nodded. "My daddy likes me to do it like that." It was the first time that he'd mentioned his dad, and I was keen to find out more. Before I could ask him anything else, though, the sound of Ben chattering on the baby monitor alerted me to the fact that he was awake. So I went upstairs to get him. I'd never fostered such a helpful child as Tom. While I got Ben some porridge, he quietly ate his breakfast. He'd already got dressed and brushed his teeth. I didn't have to remind him to do anything or chivvy him along. Long before we needed to leave, he stood waiting by the door with his coat and shoes on while I was still chasing Ben around. He'd got his school bag ready and had even filled up his water bottle. While I drove him to school, he was very quiet, hardly saying a word. I put the radio on quietly in the background, and Ben was babbling away, so I chit-chatted to him, but I didn't push Tom to speak. When we got to his school, I walked him in. I knew it was a good opportunity for me to meet his teacher and try to get a bit more background information. Tom's teacher was a young woman called Miss Henderson. As with a lot of teachers I came across these days, she looked to me as though she was far too young to be in the job, but she was probably in her early 20s like Louisa. She was petite and blonde, and she had a lovely, calm manner about her. Once Tom was settled at his table, she left the teaching assistant to sort out the class and stepped outside to have a quick chat with me. I felt so guilty getting social services involved, but I was getting more and more worried about Tom, she told me. "In what way?" I asked, curious. "There's been such a change in him," she sighed. "It's like he's shut himself off, gone into himself. He doesn't laugh or talk or to anyone or play. He doesn't seem to want to do anything at all. Of course we knew what had happened to his mum, so at first we put it down to grief. We've tried to get Dad up to school, But he didn't respond to letters, emails or phone calls. And then Tom started talking about punishments. He said his dad had hit him because he hadn't done his chores properly. And he talked about being made to scrub the floor until his fingers bled. Gosh, that's horrendous, I gasped, shocked. It suddenly made sense why Tom was so obsessed with keeping everything so clean and tidy. You did the right thing, I reassured her. Did you know Tom's mum? I asked. A little bit, she said. Jess seemed lovely, very happy, smiley and fun. She used to help out on the PTA. It was all very sudden. We heard she was ill, and in a matter of weeks, she was dead. It was heartbreaking to hear how this little boy's life had been turned upside down. Does Tom ever talk about his mum? She shook her head. Never, she sighed. I've tried, but it's like he just shuts down. I don't want to push him, as I'm conscious of upsetting him in front of the class. What's going to happen to him now? She asked, looking worried. We don't know yet, I told her. Social services are talking to his dad. Poor little lad, she sighed. Like
I said. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.